So welcome. I think I have tried to customize this presentation based on the need, and I saw the what is the objective and all. So this CNNS, I'm presenting on behalf of India. I mean, there was a huge stakeholders, government, different partners. I will also come there. So as per the objective, I was told by Shweta, like I have to focus more on adolescent part and different component of CNNS and also what it can have a policy relevance. So that I think you have in your course material. So CNNS, how many have seen the report or anything before? Can I? Almost 50%. How many are seeing first time? So again 50% almost, no? Okay. So we are claiming this to be a world largest micronutrient survey.
How many standard deviations?
Right? Yes. So this micronutrient survey, we are saying, I mean, why we are claiming this? Other survey has been with this size, but for micronutrient, more than 50,000 biosample, this is first time in any country. Even like our partner CDC and other, they claimed this is kind of, we can claim this world largest micronutrient survey ever conducted. The survey component like anthro and bio, other than anthro bio, it was over 112,000, and biochemical was 51,000, and it took a long time, I would say like almost 2 years plus, because we were doing in a phase manner in all the 30 states. And you see the right side map, it has covered across the country. And if I go to the district level, although this is representative for states, covering all the states of India, and estimate can be seen at urban or rural or within a state, male, female. Survey design was like any other large scale survey. I think people must be aware about NFHS, multi-stage sampling design. And we have covered 2000 plus primary sampling unit. You see the dot, mostly 80% plus districts we have covered. So if you see, I mean, in this will be quite representative, first time in India, and very, very relevant for program and policy. Still, we had not completed this. Like, we are presenting the data every 4 or 5 state to ministry, and policy dialogue has started even initially result what we were getting. So being the robust survey across the country, it's helpful. Some point I want to highlight, so far you have seen data either for under 5 children or adolescent starting from 15 to 19. We have covered 5 to 9 school age going children, which was very important but missed in most of the survey. Maybe a small study will be there, but no survey for national level. And also the early adolescent, like where intervention should have been started, that was missing. So you will see that data and you have already seen. I think most of the 50% people are aware it has covered the triple burden, overweight, stunting, anemia, biomarkers. I will come to the list, NCDs, micronutrient deficiency, and also detailed of cause of anemia. While taking lunch, I was discussing with, I forgot your name, sorry,
Usha.
Like 50% error. I think people are good that people are talking and using the result. So anthro, you see there are some detailed result also. Not just height and weight, we have used also MUAC and tricep skin fold thickness and also subscapular. And we do have a waist circumference for 5 to 9 and 10 to 19 years, and up to 19 all the other indicators. Biomarkers, I mean, this, see the complete list. We have anemia and hemoglobinopathy, and also C-reactive protein, because most of the indicator we have to control for that. And protein, you see the list of micronutrients, you have all, I'm sorry. Yes. Iron we have, vitamin A, zinc, B, vitamin B, B12, vitamin D, first time you will see, and also urinary iodine. And NCD we have covered blood pressure, blood glucose, for sugar we have covered both, because glucose may be like, there may not be fasting sample, so we have also taken HbA1c. Lipid profile, you can see serum cholesterol, LDL, HDL, and also the renal function. What is expected? Because I think I heard from Shweta, this is more for action, right? And this group and course is more how what can be done. So I think Poshan Abhiyan, everybody has heard about, right? I think somebody are already working on Poshan Abhiyan team. How many are from Poshan Abhiyan? Okay. What is missing in Poshan Abhiyan? Before go to that data, I will like to ask. Because this is a course, so I don't want to be only presenter. I will learn from you. What do you see missing in Poshan Abhiyan?
I mean, in policy perspective or in a data perspective?
No, policy perspective.
I
mean, data is a tool. Data is not for people.
Yeah, true. I mean, lot of areas which is completely missed out. Especially.
What are the four indicators of Poshan?
Local fit. Stunting. Wasting and then underweight. Anemia.
So are we talking about NCD?
No.
Overnutrition?
No.
Recording the session, you use the mic.
Okay. So that data will serve as a baseline, whatever you are, that's target is, and also it will open the gate for policy pitch for the area which are still neglected. And also the greater understanding of anemia, like based on the result and all. All the policy dialogue is happening, and we have seen, I was talking with Usha, now she was very angry about 100 mg, so now the policy shift is there for 60 mg. And it will also support on different micronutrients like IFA, supplementation, vitamin E, new area like vitamin D, zinc, and also lots of insight for salt iodization. And of course, NCD, which is the most neglected area and country is going to be a capital. There was a huge partnership. We have done four Ministry of Health. We were supporting in technical way. And USCD was our technical partner. AIMS, NIN, PGI, Kalawati, Saran. I mean, you see the whole list of organizations who could be all from government. And also we have a TAG member representing different variety of people in different area because the survey component was too high. You have seen the indicator. So to have a right technical support, what can be the indicator, what can be the cutoff, what will be the best method, gold standard method. We have tried to work with complete team. And SRL lab was used across the country. And we have done only analysis in reference lab, only three labs. That's why the collection, transportation, everything was very crucial. I will touch those also. This data quality assurance. If you are doing this kind of large survey across the country and very much relevance for policy, the quality assurance measure is a key, and all the efforts were made to have a very tight quality of data. So the data quality assurance team were there across the board, and even for survey and anthro, the quality standard were much rigorous and higher than any other large scale survey. I will not claim for a small survey, but large scale. Even like hiring for anthropometric team, we did a very comprehensive standardization process using the TEM score, so that the people who are managing the global standard, they are only hired to do the survey. I think this was not done any of the previous survey. Not more than four interviews. Sometimes there is a fatigue of doing seven or six, then data quality of survey, diet, even measurement, everything suffer. And also tracking, because there was a biochemical. If you see this was the cool box, where this is the actual from field. You see the kind of tubes are there, right? And how they are being transported, where they collected, then collection center to reference lab. So there was a tracking system. And along with that, we have used the data loggers, digital data logger, which were maintaining the temperature. Okay, in PSU, like in summer, it was collected in 30 degrees centigrade. But this cool box was able to maintain temperature 2 to 8 degree up to 16 hours. This means from PSU to collection point, like from village, household, it is going to collection point within 8 or 10 hours. Then they are repacking it, and again they are sending to the reference lab. So all the quality checks, all the quality control were managed and also validated with the TAG members before we analyzed the result and presented the result for discussion. So this is the background I wanted to give so that you see the kind of intensity was taken for reference. This is example of global cutoff of TEM. If you see this, the top line, the blue one, this is a global for intra and inter is 0.69 centimeter. I'm giving the example of height, which is more difficult to measure rather than weight. So if you see all our states, the blue bar is well below the global cutoff of 0.95 centimeter. And even in intra also, which was 0.69, all the states in the green bar below the cutoff. So who were not able to manage those cutoffs, they were not hired. So I will run through some of the key findings, I think, but some maybe repeat you have already seen in report or something, but I have tried to organize in three domains: undernutrition and micronutrient deficiency, then overnutrition and NCD, and possible factors like diet, lifestyle, and sedentary lifestyle, and so on. One quarter are still thin in country level. This indicator is BMI for age as per the WHO recommendation for, because if you just take BMI, it will not serve the purpose for 10 to 14. And some of the states are like even one third, like if you see Madhya Pradesh, Haryana, Gujarat, Rajasthan, 30% or so, they are thin. Some of the states in hilly area, they are better off, but if you see this, every fifth or fourth girls or boy, they are remaining thin, which is not good, because still we focus on Poshan Abhiyan under 5, and like our stunting, wasting, I'm not presenting those data because of the session and time. Like 30 or 40%, 35%, but they are remaining thin or underweight still up to 10 or 19 year age. So this means there is something missing in between to catch up. Anemia, some good news, but not that good, because if the prevalence of anemia is around 10 to 12% lower in CNNS, not because of intervention or not because of there is a sudden change in 2 years, but mainly because of the method. We have used the gold standard method, took the venous blood and used that. And other survey, what they use? Can anyone answer NFHS, what they use for anemia? Any, all use blood, but blood from where? Hemocube, yes. And I mean, there are lots of literature. Capillary blood, right? So which is the gold standard blood, free-flowing blood? It's a venous blood. So first of all, you use the site of the blood, which is the most efficient on gold, and the second, the method. Like hemocube is a field method, but this cyanamet method is the gold standard, and 10 to 12% lower prevalence was noticed, but still, if you see the variations across the states, it was very high. And especially, if we see the adolescent girl, see the transition, see this transition. From up to 10 to 11 year, male and female both are having the similar level of deficiency, like anemia prevalence. But after 11, there is a divide, right? So after 12, all the girls are 40% or higher level of anemia. If you see the state-wise variation also, country level, 40% versus 18% among boys and girls. And that difference is consistent across the states, whether prevalence was little lower side or even higher side, like Jharkhand, Tripura, and West Bengal. This is very interesting finding. Once you don't see the data by gender, what happens for the programming? The first map, the red zone, as a public health problem, as per WHO, if any prevalence is more than 40%, they are supposed to be severe public health problem, or 20 to 30 moderate. So in the severe zone, once we put the data in overall, they are just one or two states. But once we see only for female, almost 10 or more states are coming in a severe public health problem zone. You see the severe public health problem. So almost all. I did put the map, I'm not presenting here, and the deficiency of iron. This map and that map were very similar. This means still, there is a need of intervention of iron. Like 22% Indians are deficient in iron as well. And this is very interesting slide. I think you must have seen in report also we have tried to put. I'm presenting all the age group, but I think let's focus there. 12% are anemic. They are also iron deficient. 9.5% are iron deficient but not anemic. This means almost half. And this light, this orange one, anemic but not iron deficient, but iron deficient but not anemic. This means out of like 29 or 30% deficiency, 50% or so, that's more in the lower age group, and but little less in this age group, but still like, and the state-wise variation were very much evident. So, and we do have a lot of analysis on this, and that is again going on. I would like to also give this audience, like we are going to have a subgroup for different policy. Ministry has already announced, VESA is part of one or two subgroup. I mean, maybe other people, I don't know by the name. But we are going to grow that community in more relevant way if like people from other country, university, they are supportive. We are going to have them also on board for analysis and review so that a very concrete analysis is done for a better policy. Vitamin A, the prevalence was more or less similar in all the age group. So whatever intervention is done, it's not really affecting the other age group, and up to adolescent also the prevalence of 16% is evident, and there is a huge state variation. If you see this map, because we do have program for under 5 children for vitamin A supplementation, but there is no program for adolescent. Sweta, am I right or? Okay. So this means if you are not doing any supplementation program or universal coverage, there has to be done something about their diet, their counseling, vitamin rich food. I think I will come to those slides at the end, but I think let's focus more on the data and what the slides are saying. B12 deficiency, because the session is for adolescent, but I kept the slide for other age group. Over the age, the deficiency is going. Under 5 were 14% deficient, then it was 17% in 5 to 9, and then 31%, almost twice. And that differential is consistent across the state, irrespective of their level of prevalence. Vitamin D deficiency. Some of the people sitting in that corner can anyone answer why this deficiency is more in these states? Gujarat, Haryana, Punjab, because I see, I mean, lots of people are from diet and Sweta. This group is very diverse, I heard from you. So, there is a dietary pattern on vitamin D also, I mean, because of diets, and other region is sunlight. So, maybe this reason.
You don't see the sun here.
No, they see sun, but
with all the small.
I think. See, I've tried today. Prevalence is so that lower prevalence in May to September and higher prevalence during the winter period of heavy air pollution. We have tried to diagnose all the data by seasonality by month, and it was evident. Like suddenly that was going very high that season. And again, diet. Like if you see, lots of indicator by micronutrient. I will run through again. I mean, there are a few more. Like the states were mostly vegetarian, like Gujarat, Haryana, even Punjab. I'm not defining vegetarian means if they are not taking very frequent. This is dairy, but not
non-vegetarian.
It's interesting.
Because Punjab
is known for dairy intake.
Dairy.
Food sources,
okay, we can see that association later. And there is some good news about urinary iodine. Previously, there were lots of states who were not having adequate level of iodine, but this survey shows they are not just adequate, but they do have more than adequate also, lots of states listed here. And also, excess, like Chennai, Tamil Nadu is going for excess. So based on this data, I will just like there are policy discussion in programming also whether currently salt iodization is 30 or more ppm minimum. Now FSSI is trying to limit between 15 to 30 so that. And what happens because of this having minimum 30 or more, sometimes the level is 40, 50, 60. So they have to maintain minimum 30. So there is no benchmark of 5. So that kind of intervention. I mean, this kind of data is telling, no, I mean, you can't just push iodine across the board. And we see the other problem of hypothyroid and other thing because of this high intake of
overnutrition. Anybody knows the India data of NFHS? What is the status of overnutrition?
Were they listening before lunch?
Yeah, we were just discussing what percentages.
Overweight or obese, if you club both, and there is very interesting pattern, because I was working in NFHS 2 also. So that time we were MN 3, 2, I mean all continuous, Sweta. The prevalence is going like 2, 4, 8, 16. So there is kind of that progression. That's like overall. But if you see the urban India, now how much percentage of India is urban? Any rough guess? If you see the new data, maybe 2021. How much will be urbanization in India?
65.
No. In 2011, it was 30-31. It will be close to 40% because the big cities and all. And half of the states are crossing 50 or more, like Maharashtra, Goa, Tamil Nadu, Kerala. So this NCD, I mean, I want to give that background because those are very important for policy platform. Because, I mean, there was a time when you talk about urban, okay, this is for the small pockets or something. No, your half of the population is going to be urban. Or even people who are living in rural area, their lifestyle, their dietary habit, their other thing is very much influenced by urban because of very frequent migration also, influence of media, social media. So even people living in remote, you see the Coca-Cola, you see the factory, you see the, I think Sweta can give more light on that. It was a phenomena of urban area, but you go to the village, while doing this in the survey in 2035 PSUs, I have visited almost 100 plus, and I was not able to get any nutritious food in the remote village, but Coca-Cola was there, Kurkure was there, chips was there, so biscuit across the board, if you go to any household, they will offer Coca-Cola, biscuits and chips. I mean, even in Punjab, which is a place of lassi and milk, the Coca-Cola is the first choice now across it. So this slide is very important. In urban, in adult, overweight and obesity is more than underweight, just like a data. And even they are not starting in 30, 40 or 50, they are starting at very early age. 4% were in 5 to 9 and 5% across the country. But if you see like some of the states like Kerala, Goa, Tamil Nadu, they are more urban. 10% or more kids are overweight or obese.
We don't have data segregated for urban rural here.
Yeah, we do have. You see the report, it is all there. Yeah. So NCD. I just gave the background of overweight and obesity. So NCD is on rise. This was very surprising, and we tried to diagnose, is this true data, like 10% of children at that age, they are pre-diabetic. Not just from serum sugar, but also based on HbA1c indicator. 10% are also having high triglyceride, 4% having high cholesterol, 5% having hypertension, and the last bullet, if you see, this was also very, very surprising for us. So chronic kidney disease, it was also prevalent in some pockets. So national level prevalence is coming at 7, but in some area, I will go in detail in further slides. And that variation is there. If you see the pre-diabetic, it's coming up to like 20 plus, almost 7 to 8 states. And this number is going to go like anything. If I repeat this survey in 2022, maybe half of the states will be more than the kind of pattern we are noticing. So either you do through a serum glucose based on that indicator, or this, both are telling the same story. So which is like, because we did try to collect our data, biosample collection in the early morning, even like people were there at 6:30 in the morning, and by 8:30 all the data are collected. Like in a day-to-day basis, we were doing only 5 or 6 samples in one PSU. So in one PSU, 20-30, so in a week, we were staying there for a week, and so that data quality, data management is done well. high cholesterol that, or even triglyceride, it's up to 30% in like West Bengal or Manipur. And India level, it's 10. Hypertension, it is, I mean, supposed to be a problem of middle age or 40 or 50. Like I'm now 45, I'm thinking I should have be very careful of my diet and lifestyle, but things are starting very early age. Some states like Delhi, we are sitting in the highest zone. This I was talking about, chronic kidney disease. If you see some of the states like Telangana and Andhra, there is a huge clustering. Some places like West Bengal and some places in Northeast. So the ministry was very keen, and they are trying to have more. And we did review from our literature, previous literature. So lots of paper and data is coming. Although they are very in micro level, they are also reporting. So we did try to triangulate these things.
Is there some link between pesticide usage in these areas?
That could be. Maybe something on. Because I did see, like in a PSU of like 20 kids,
yeah,
sometimes all 20 or 18 are having problem.
Having
so this means there is high
high
cholesterol. That's why rather than showing the prevalence, yeah, I'm trying to show you the kind of cholesterol.
Were you able to figure out some reasons why high serum creatinine in kids? Because that's kind of...
It could be environmental region, it could be. And the study has shown those environmental problems. There should have been some common factor. Otherwise, in a cluster, in a village, if we have taken sample from 20 kids, almost 16, 17, 18 are reporting it to be high. So, I mean, that's why we need a further investigation, further exploration.
Like, because since it's kidney, mostly it has a relation to medicines too. And over-the-counter medicines, like India is just known for it. You can get any NSAID to medicine like this. And usually in rural areas, this is what they prefer, not going to a doctor rather than to a pharmacy and get the medicine.
But if that was the case,
yeah, that's
I would
I'm
have
asking
seen
was,
across the board.
And that's
so
the
that
I'm
may
asking.
Be a factor which is fueling more.
Yeah.
But the main
yeah,
reason is not the
yeah.
medicine. But I see at least see
that's
from this
the reason
data
I'm asking
point of view. But that could be like more environmental.
Maybe water, maybe other issue. If you see, and we did notice in other literature that there is a water problem of like fluoride and other thing in this region. So that's why, because we can't answer everything from this data. We want to put this data across the researcher and policymakers and program manager so that they do further investigation, triangulate with other data, other environmental data. Although we are also supporting, I mean, we are working with IIT Delhi, so that they are pulling together those data in our PSU's list and try to work out those for more solid or
is
more.
That blue cluster, Mumbai, Greater Mumbai, by which ones?
Mumbai is this, right?
Yeah.
So that's not in the red zone.
That
could be. So I am not going to present here very depth analysis of association, but kind of a top line finding about their adolescent's dietary intake, physical activity, and sedentary behavior. But further, we can see, I mean, if low, medium, high, or something, then what is the implication on their NCD and other things. So first question, are adolescent girls and boys eating the recommended diets? So see the situation. Only 8% are taking eggs, chicken, and at least twice also, just 20%, means 80% are not. Fruits, unaffordable. Even daily, I mean, 90% or plus are not able to take that. Some good news about milk, because there is a historical pattern, even people, because having cattle and all are there since historic time, so I see. I don't know the reason why all of a sudden milk is that high. But again, if you talk about the quantity, it may not be sufficient. And see this, huge gender differential. 77% boys adolescent are getting milk daily, but only 44% of girls, means more than half girls are not even getting milk. So this variation you can see very much evident. First it will be given to boy, if that is left over, then girl will take.
Given that we have surplus milk production in our country, why is there such a, why is there not percolation of consumption? Is there any thought on
that? If you compare with any other data like fruits, vegetables or even fish, eggs, so at least you are giving your answer. That's where it's like 8 to 80, right? It's reaching. But other things are not reaching. And you see the cost, like in urban area, milk is 50 rupees a liter. Think about a poor household who are earning like 400 or 300 per day. If they buy 3 liter of milk, their 30% income will go in just a milk. Think about their other need of electricity, school, and so they have to survive in 100 rupees. So they can't afford this much. So rest 23% here and 54% there are mostly from the lower income group. Maybe, I mean, further research, further analysis can be done. Who are the people who are not affording it? Even like, why then there is a food insecurity? We have like surplus 30% of grain. So it's the distribution, affordability and all.
I just want to ask on the milk part. This is direct consumption of milk, right?
Yes.
Like, and not like, because like, you know, in rural areas, kids also drink milk in other forms, with tea, coffee, which is like high milk content, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is just direct consumption of milk,
this is
not
milk,
like
yeah.
Products.
Milk as a, yeah. But we do have other data also whether they have taken other products and all.
Okay.
So one can go micro. But once you are taking tea, it can be hardly 20, 30, 40 grams. Like you take tea 100 milliliter. I think the people who are pure nutritionists, they can comment more on that. I'm more of a like not pure nutrition person, but more of a survey and design and this person. So I think we can discuss more in. So even see the pulses and beans, which is now, I would say, more affordable than the previous time. Consumption is very low. So this data, what's missing from the food plate? This is not daily, this is weekly. Even weekly, 62% boys and 68% girls, they are missing egg. Same proportion about fish and chicken, fruits, 60%, even weekly, forget about daily and twice or thrice in a week. Even weekly basis, people are not getting milk, 20% or 40% girls. Even so this is, I mean, we have seen the micronutrient deficiencies across the age group or even adolescent, like 20, 30, 40. So this means these are the possible reasons we have to go and deep dive in the data to see the association, even controlling for other factors, where we have made the working group and we are going to start very soon. Once data will be released, maybe in January. This is again interesting. Pakora, samosa, it's there, right? Fried foods, 12 to 15%. And this is 3 times in a week. Not like during this weekend, I'm going to eat samosa. No, I will eat on Sunday. I will eat on Tuesday and also on Thursday. So this is more than, if you go to the previous slide, this is more than what? This is more than egg. This is more than other nutrients or better nutritious product. This is very interesting slide. If you see the physical activity, outdoor activity basically, which is in red, I should have given that green color, and screen time. The screen time we have like asked very minutely with all, Monday to Friday, Saturday, Sunday, how much they spend. So then we have computed. The screen time is 3, TV watching, mobile, or tab. Anything related to screen, which is there. So over the age, it's going up in boys as well as in girls. Outdoor activity after certain time, once you have a pressure of board, I can see in my house also.
I have a 15-year boy now. So after this time, he was joining a club, a sports club and all. Now this is 10th class. So he is going down. So I push him to go at least for an hour and play with paper. Yes.
I have a question. Like you have included screen time and outdoor physical activity time. Now, so far as physical activity sustainability is concerned, and especially when girls are taken into consideration,
mm-hmm.
sweeping the floor, pocha lagana, all this is really, I mean, that's a physical activity.
No, this is that's how you say the outdoor.
No, no, that is what I am asking. That indoor physical activities are also, you know,
important.
Yeah. So. Have you included?
No, we do have in data about all those details, but my
interest was more because if you see these population 15 to 19 or 10 to 14, this is more of a school going age or college going age. So if you talk about adult, that will be more like mother. If you asking the mother's behavior, like
of the age
yeah.
that happens. Yeah.
But like 14 year till 12 year and all, it's
year,
more,
years, yeah.
I mean, in certain pockets, it's
yes.
not across the board. Like your kids, I mean, if my maid is not coming, I will be the person or my wife together can sit, but it will not my kids who are going to do that. I mean, but of course, they're very relevant, and even in my work of
my PhD, I have done that, and women, my work on overweight and obesity among women. I have seen the change from one point of time to another point of time. And your this indicator, whether they are sweeping and sweeping, that was very, very correlated. Who were doing that, their increase in BMI was the minimum. So that's the best exercise. So if you see the outdoor activity, again, that's going down among the girl. This is girl. It's going down among the girl, but boys, there was relatively better. So, I'm not going depth in more data, but data will be in your plate maybe in next 2 to 3 weeks. And you go and analyze. And I would like to summarize the key findings. We have seen the triple burden of malnutrition, stunting, overweight, and anemia. Half of the anemia was due to iron. More than 3 micron, I have not presented that slide. But almost 20% were having more than 3 micronutrient deficiency. So there is a policy dialogue happening. Should we shift from single or one or two to a multi micronutrients powder or that kind of intervention? Vitamin D is a emerging area and more in urban, more in adolescent. So we have a policy group who are going to do more depth review of our vitamin D data and can suggest kind of possible policies. NCD is of course emerging. We have seen those details. Diet is poor. I don't know how to, until unless we make it affordable or more knowledge about the diet. Sweta is there or she is busy in managing. That is the area. Until unless we fix that, our both problem will persist. Either we talk about NCD or we talk about micronutrients deficiency. And poor food habits, like fried food is more than any other. So we can buy samosa in 10 rupees, but egg we can buy in 5 rupees also. So it's all about diet nutrition. And sedentary lifestyle we have seen. The screen time is going on. Outdoor activity is decreasing. This is very preliminary policy implications, I am saying, because still we are debating on data review, all the program based on final policy implications and policy papers and policy recommendation will be done. But of course, there is very clear-cut implications which is emerging from our data. Like half of the anemia is caused by iron, so program needs to continue that supplementation. But again, like other half, we have to take a like. It's like focusing more on deworming and other infections so that even the implications of iron is seen. Vitamin D, we have also seen in under 5, it's coming much better. But still, whether we should go with the supplementation program twice or maybe selected geography, that can be a debate. But more than that, dietary and fortification can work because we need know the coverage. No matter whatever program we do as a, the kind of implications, the kind of reach out, we talk about C square IQ, coverage, intensity, stock out, lots of problem is there. So that's not the solution for each and every program. We have to have in a very basics and general diets and maybe fortification of a larger thing. Vitamin D, I have already discussed. So that's one area. Iodine, I did discuss while presentation. FSSI is already working, and maybe we have a final policy of making a band between 15 to 30 ppm. NCD program, there are lots of program, but the kind of coverage, the kind of knowledge, the kind of reach out is has to be worked upon. And creatinine, of course, there that has to be dealt, so that it's like during that, even we do have data to 5 to 9, even that age also, so that has to be done something for program. And I started with some Poshan colleague. We have only malnutrition or anemia, so overnutrition, NCD has to be looked out or aligned on the other coin of the nutrition. Thank you. I want to thank all the partners who were engaged. The survey was supported by Aditya and Megha Mittal and Population Council, AIIMS, CDC, and you can see all the data, all the report in Nutrition India Info. We have a website, not just NNS data, all the nutrition data you can see in a fingertip. If there is a online system, is there an internet there? So I can just present one or two live. Okay, so you log in if someone is working on internet in this, make that as a home page. Whatever data you want to see for nutrition, it's there. You can see the trend of all the NFHS, RSOC, CNNS data, by state, whatever data at district level you can see there. We have developed that and supported government. And map, pattern, ranking. So even you are going for any presentation of something, you don't need to worry. You are sitting in flight and next hour your presentation is ready once you are landing. Yes. It's under approval of ministry. Maybe in January we are going to organize a workshop, data as a workshop. So that first we may be in Mumbai, Delhi. We are going to have a 5 regional workshop where we are trying to work closely with all the stakeholders who are interested. So maybe who are interested, you can give your card or email to me or write to me, so that while we are designing that workshop, we can include you people. So some of the things I have kept as an extra slide, there are huge variation on data collection. Once you are comparing between the one survey to another, do compare their timing, because lots of indicators like wasting, huge seasonality. If you are doing data collection in January, February or October, November, December, the level of wasting in India is around 10 to 12. If you are doing in June, July, August, it will be almost 20%. So it has to be taken care of when the data collection was done and you are comparing the two survey. So I have kept in this, maybe I can share this, no problem. I compared with NFHS versus CNSS timing. Sometime some indicator are also in common in both, but most of the data what I presented, it's like not there. Precautions, sometime N is too smaller for some of the subgroup analysis. So be cautious once you are receiving the data. I think I'm not going in this detail because of time. And in last slide, there are all the methods what were used for biochemical analysis that's given. That's also given in the report. Go through report, digest it, ask it, write us, and discuss within your research group. So thank you, and I'm ready to have this. Yes.
So before lunch, we were discussing the prevalence of overweight in adolescents. And we were concerned, kind of trying to work out what the magnitude of the problem was. And you've reported that the prevalence of being more than one standard deviation above the reference is 5%. What does does your organization think is an action level that is indicative of a problem of overweight at a public health level in given that number relative to the reference population? Is 5% too much because 16% is expected? Right, so kind of, could you kind of help us understand that? Because we were discussing before the lunch and we didn't have a discussion.
It's very important and very good observation. That's why if you see the Poshan Abhiyan, although I was talking about Poshan Abhiyan to incorporate overweight and other component, because it's, if you see the prevalence level of current, it's not a public health problem. But if you see the kind of change it's happening, like once you cross 2025, if you see any research published on overweight and obesity, age is the biggest covariate. Like it changed like anything. I remember my analysis long back when even prevalence was very less. The odds ratio was maximum in terms of age. The age was the biggest covariate, even higher than diet or even sedentary lifestyle in other data. I have not seen that. So, because it's not like if you, this is 5% among 10 to 19 or 15 to 19, but if you don't do any good intervention at that time, not as a like, maybe preventive, like activity, physical activity, avoid those junk foods and diet, that can be initiated that time. Otherwise, if you see the NCD is also there, the kind of overweight, obesity prevalence, because we don't have data for 20 plus, but we do have data in NFHS, very time series data, which says urban overweight and obesity is more than underweight. So I don't have exact answer. That's where the policy has not taken that as a very serious or very serious attention on underage. But of course, policy is not just made for under 5 or 5 to 9 or 10 to 19. Policy has to be comprehensive. Women Poshan Abhiyan, it's not just for children. It's for women and adult also, right? So, of course, that's a missing link. And because there are no good data, don't see overweight as a single indicator. Even my point will be that. Always see overweight related with its manifestation, like NCD problem, other problems. So if you see things in totality and the kind of shift it's happening, like just like 2024, the prevalence is more than 10% country level. 25 to 30, prevalence is 15%. 30 to 35, so it's like multiplying effect. So in that way, because if you see just one point of data in one angle, you will not be very worried and do advocacy for any policy. I hope I have answered your query a bit, given limited data here.
I have a very different question.
Please go ahead.
How did you convince the Mittals to support this?
No, we have not convinced Mittal to do the survey itself.
No,
it was more about the nutrition. They were interested in nutrition. Then we convinced that your 10-15 million will not change the program and policy, right? But the better information, in-depth information done with government, they are going to be a more long-lasting effect and kind of, see, if you invest $15 million in any of the program, if you see the size of funding from government, $15 million not even come as a 0.001%, right? So that was the convincing point, and they were interested partner for, and we did the survey for Maharashtra first, Maharashtra Nutrition Survey. Then it was quite valued. Then they were interested more depth, more like, all totality. That's why we call it comprehensive, and you see the kind of comprehensiveness it has. So that was the convincing point. Thank you.